event tonight. My pleasure to have Jean Germain from Sarasota, Florida, actually, but now living in the Berkshires, I think, here to talk to you about her book featuring the jazz greats of the last century, basically, right? And a few from this century as well. But before we dive into that, I'd just like to make a plug for the library's upcoming fundraising concert, which will be on Saturday, September 21st. And it's all in the theme of tonight's talk, because it's going to be a jazz concert with some dancing involved, if you would like, at the American Legion on September 21st. And Chris Backridges, who's in the audience tonight, Chris plays over at Bloomington and other places, but he's gathered a quartet together to do a fundraiser for the library. And it's going to be on the Great American Songbook, the great songs of Cole Porter, Isaiah Berlin. Chris, name a few for me.
Sure, you got it. George Gershwin. George Gershwin. That's right. Jerome Kern. Wow. And you're right, Jerry, it is in keeping with the theme. The book that Gene wrote is so important, and the music, because the music is so important.
That's right.
So we're delighted to get together. Hopefully we can swing half as much as we're going to be swinging tonight.
We'll swing with you on 21st.
So, and only tonight, we have a special deal for you. We have the sale of the book, Gene's book, and a ticket for $40. It's a great deal. So if you're so inclined, you can buy a ticket for the event and get Gene's fabulous book. So, but we're here to hear Gene talk about these great people that she saw in Sarasota. And all I'm going to say, because Jean's going to tell you the story about her coming together with these jazz greats, she is a retired elementary school teacher who retired to Florida in 1979, and from that point on, she has her story for us tonight. And I'm going to play a little Charlie Rose up here, and perhaps things that come to mind, well, I will ask her, but of course the audience can participate in this as well, so if she says something that you have a question about, please interrupt her and she'll answer. But
thank you so much, Jerry. I'm really very honored that I'm here.
Well, the honor's all ours.
And I want to introduce my daughter, Wendy, who came down to Sarasota, Florida many times and met some of these great legends that you will see on the screen. So if I forget something, she's going to fill me in. But she knows almost as much as I do. And I really, in my wildest dreams, and I do have a lot of dreams, I never knew or felt that I would ever be putting a book together or ever meeting these wonderful legends. And it goes back to 1980, and you'll see, we put them on the screen for you to see. So there's not much that I can talk to you right now about, so you'll see it on the screen. Go ahead. Oh, Wendy, I said, that's why she's here. Okay. I retired as a school teacher, Montessori school, and I moved to Sarasota, Florida. And it's a long story, but I met Hal Davis, who was the publicist for Benny Goodman for 35 years. His father was a society band leader in the 30s, so all these legends came down to his house, so he knew these legends. And what happened is that he was with Benny Goodman for 35 years, and he wanted to keep jazz alive, because jazz is the original American jazz art form. And so he wanted to keep jazz alive, and you will see how he kept it alive for all the years that the big band legends were playing and some of the younger ones were coming down. We'll see that on the screen there. So without talking too much, I have so many stories to tell you, I had to write everything down, because all of them played with the big bands, and they really, so many things to say about them.
Want to start with Benny?
So now, what happened to me, Hal Davis came to me and said, this when he started the jazz club in Sarasota, Florida, where I live. And he said, I'm starting a jazz club, And could you take some photographs for our newsletter for the jazz club, because I'm inviting some of the legends down in 1980. I said to him, I just retired as a school teacher. I don't know the difference between an F-stop and a truck stop. So he said, you know, if you take a couple of workshops, you know, you'll learn how to do this in a couple of months. So I took a couple of workshops, and the first time that I went to take a photograph, I got my Nikon camera and my flash on, and he said to me, what are you doing? I said, you told me to take photographs. He says, you can't use flash while the performance is going on. This was the beginning of the jazz club festivals. So I said, well, I'll set up my tripod. He said, you can't use a tripod because it's going to interfere with everybody. So I said to him, well, maybe I'll go behind the stage or on the side of the stage and I'll be able to take some of these. He says, you can't do that. You're going to interfere with the musicians. I said, well, what do you want me to do? He said, and this is a big performing arts center in Sarasota, Florida, the very Van Wezel Performing Arts Center, very big performing arts center where we had all of our jazz festivals. So he said, and this is why the book is called Jazz in Row 6. He said to me, you sit up in Row 6, there's a seat there for you. I said, how am I going to take the photographs? Can I use my, you can't use flash. I said, what do you want me to do for light? He said, the stage lighting. So for 26, 27 years, I was a prisoner of Row 6. And that's where all the photographs were taken. So I just wanted to mention that to you, because when you see some of the photographs, like Benny Waters, and you see that I did that with a special Kogan filter. I don't know how many of you are photographers, but I had to do certain creative things, so the lighting was not the greatest lighting. So we're going to go through all of these, and we're talking about the originals. Benny Waters was born in 1902, and he died in 1998. At the age of 93, photographing Benny was a thrill for me. And I said to him after the concert was over, I said, Benny, how can you play like that when you're 93 years old? And he says to me, Jean, he says, it doesn't make any difference how old you are, either you play or you don't play. And that was him. So he died in 1998. And his career went all the way back to King, who I don't know who it was, King Oliver's band in 1920. So that was Benny. The next one is Claude Fiddler Williams. He was born in 1908 and he died in 2004 at the age of 86. I photographed Fiddler, who was one of the foremost Kansas City sound musicians. He was Count Basie's first guitar artist, but preferred the violin. So he played both. He earned a nickname, Fiddler. Why was he Fiddler? Because when he was touring with his group, that's where they named him the Fiddler. Well, Milt Hinton is my favorite, because Milt Hinton was also a wonderful photographer. He wrote three books. Now, the one time that they allowed me to go out of Row 6 in the afternoon, there was a rehearsal, and I belonged to a photography club, mm-hmm. and they said, we will allow each one of the group from the photography club to come to the concert to the rehearsal in the afternoon, and you only have a half an hour to be on the stage. So I'm photographing Milt, the judge, which is what he's called. And I'm taking a picture of him, which you don't see here, but all of a sudden, while I'm photographing him, he pulls out his camera and he's taking a picture of me. So he was one of the most recorded musicians of all time, and the Dean of American Bass Players. His big band tunes heard on early rock and roll by the Drifters and Coasters. He taught himself how to play the bass in 1929, and after studying the violin, he told me that studying the violin gave him the ability to play melody on the bass. I got to be very friendly with Milt, and just wanted to say, meeting all of these legends, they were so humble. If I gave them a compliment, they would come give me a compliment back. They were so incredible. They never talked about themselves and how famous they were and how many bands they played with. And he was, the judge was my favorite.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Why, do you know why he was called the judge?
There was a whole group of, yeah. Mm-hmm. Because he was always there telling everybody what to do.
Oh.
You know, so it was probably more than that, but he never told me. That's good. Ask me the questions, you know, that I might, Wendy's going to fill me in case I forget a few things. Okay, Buddy Tate. Oh, wow. He was the first one who started to play with us in 1981. And he was born in 1912. He died in 2001. He was 89 years old. So all of these musicians were in their 70s and 80s and 90s when I photographed them. And of course, they're not alive anymore, so this is like history to me. So Buddy Tate had a big tenor sax sound going back to the Andy Kirk Band. Do anybody know about the Andy Kirk Band?
When the Clowns of Joy. That was fantastic because that was Mary Lou Williams, a great pianist's first band. And she was also not only able to play with them and record with them, but she also wrote and arranged for the group. Now, here was a woman in the 1920s, and an African-American woman to boot, performing and arranging for a first-rate territory band.
Wow.
You know,
I just came across a book of the American, what is women in jazz?
Yes.
The American women in jazz in 1900s?
Yeah.
We don't know about these women who were playing. They were playing the saxophone and the drums and everything.
Indeed.
Yeah. So Buddy Tate, going back to Andy Kirk Band with Count Basie, and he said, quote, "A jazz solo should tell a story, not just a virtuoso display of lung capacity and dexterity." That was his quote. Bob Haggard, one of my favorites. I got to know him so well. He came down to practically every concert from 1980 up until almost the time he died. He died in 1998 at the age of 84. And he first came to prominence in the 1930s, playing and composing and arranging for the Bob Crosby Orchestra. In addition, of course, we all know South Rampart Street Parade. He composed Big Noise from Winnetka, which he's very noted for, and What's New for Linda Ronstadt in 1983. You all remember Linda Ronstadt. So I got to know Bob Haggard so well, and we went out for dinner together. And again, you know, you talk to these wonderful legends, and you know, you think that they're so great that you're afraid to even talk to them, but they were very, very, very friendly with all of us.
Jean, did you say Linda Ronstadt?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. She has a new biography coming out.
Did yeah, unfortunately, that? She's well, there was an article about her. She's very ill now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was the Times.
Yeah, but he was very involved with her. Okay, so now the Hootie McShane, J. Hootie McShane, born in 1916, died in 2006 at the age of 90. He was the last of the great piano players who epitomized the Kansas City sound. The last one of the Kansas City sound, right?
Boy, you ain't kidding. But he was the real deal, right? And helped to give Charlie Parker his start.
Oh.
And as a matter of fact, he was one of, the legend has it that he was the one who named him the bird.
Oh.
There's a whole story behind that.
You've got to read a new book for me.
Oh, no.
he was a great performer. And, it was and he was equally at home playing blues, boogie-woogie, ballads, and jazz. He had all kinds of ways that he could play. I loved him. He was really terrific. So, let's see, I think now we're coming to the big band swings. We had Lionel Hampton, the Count Basie Band, and Illinois Duquette. So there is Lionel Hampton.
And Fritz.
And Fritz. Thank you, Wendy. And Jerry Jerome. Phillips. Jackson in the background over there, and Bob Haggard, and then a young Howard Alden. And so they always like to include some of the younger ones with the legends, which I'll go into later on to show you how they wanted the younger generation to play with them so that they could keep jazz alive, because jazz was the American's original art form. And so that was, and he was jumping around there and leading the group and having a great time.
So you were taking this picture from row six?
Alden.
So you weren't up above, you were...
I was in my seat, and I had to go over to my side, to the left or to my right, because the microphones were in front of them, and it was very difficult to take those photographs. So anybody sitting on either side of me was unbelievably... I was very unpopular with them. They said, "Jean, why are you making so much noise?" And then I was having this Nikon camera that was making a lot of noise, and my friend said to me, who was sitting next to me, "I can't hear anything. Your camera's making too much noise." So I went out to buy another Nikon camera that was silent. But
how far away were you from the stage?
Row six.
Well, yeah, but is that 20 feet? 10 feet?
More than 20 feet. Tell them what lens you were using.
Yeah.
What lens were you using?
Oh, yeah. I needed a wide angle lens. Because I have another DVD that I just do on photography.
No, but just what is the lens?
Yeah. So taking a wide angle lens of orchestras, I needed a 28, 24 wide angle. And then when I went up close, all the close ups, I had a 300 millimeter, it's a zoom from 70 to 300. And the other one was 24 to 120. And then I used to use the Copen filters. Oh, so you're a photographer.
Yeah. What kind of filters?
The Copen filters. You see some of the things that I showed you that has a special effect?
Yeah.
You take I wasn't going to go into photography, but you had a holder that you screwed onto your lens, and then there's a plastic, and you just slide it in there.
Right.
And sometimes the center is very clear, so I was able to get the clearness, and then everything on the side was... You'll see in some of those.
Right.
Okay, I'm by the band. Okay. In 1996, I photographed the Basie Orchestra, played under the direction of Grover Mitchell.
Yes.
Yeah. And Basie first formed his band in 1935, introducing the world to the Kansas City beat. Anything you want to add to that?
Boy, you said it all.
Yeah, okay. And here we have Illinois Jacquet's big band. At the age of 19, Jacquet recorded his sax solo called Flying Home in 1942. His band toured until his death in 2004. So these guys were around for a long time, and they played like like they were youngsters. Now we're coming to the women in jazz, and I mentioned that I have this book that I found. I think Wendy got it for me. These women were playing in 1920, 1900s. So we had Dorothy Donegan, Eartha Kitt, Mary McLaughlin, Lillette Jenkins, Carrie Smith, Jane Jarvis, and
we did Cleo Lean. We didn't update it yet, but
okay.
Yeah.
So we have Dorothy Donegan. Mm-hmm. Okay, here we go. Mm-hmm. Dorothy Donegan was a character. She was born in 1922. Died in 1998 at the age of 76. Now, it's very interesting. She was classically trained. And I found out when I started to do the biography for my book, so many of them were classically trained before they became jazz. Milt Tinley was classically trained. A lot of them played in the symphonies. So Dorothy Donegan was classically trained as a pianist at the age of six. And so when I heard her play at one of the concerts, she would start playing, and she would be playing jazz, 2/4, T for two, and all kinds. And all of a sudden, she started to play Beethoven and Bach. And she would go into, so these musicians were so talented, they could go from one thing to another. And
Dave Brubeck was like that too, wasn't he, a little bit? Because I remember listening to this the CD of his performance at the Lighthouse, and all of a sudden it sounded like Rachmaninoff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these great riffs on the piano. I'm thinking, mm-hmm. where did I hear that?
Now, I have a quote from her. I just wrote it down. She said, if you're going to entertain, and she was always clowning around. She always wore a different hat every time she came, and she's noted for that. And she, and this is her quote, if you're going to entertain, use the hip shaking. A little hip shaking never hurt anybody, and gets up and said to everybody, are you listening? I have that in my book. Let me see, who are we now? Eartha Kitt was born on a cotton plantation in South Carolina. She went on her career to a career in television, a cabaret theater, played Batman and the Batman television series. She was born in 1927 and died in 2008. I photographed her in 2007, was probably the last photograph that was ever taken of her. And she was playing and singing and having a wonderful time. All of a sudden, music stopped, and I thought that the whole performance was over, and I was putting my camera away. All of a sudden, the music started again, and she parts her gown and sticks her leg out and says, "At the age of 80, I'm still some sexy dame." and then, at that point, when the music started, I was ready. When music stopped, I was putting my camera away, and I had only two pictures left there. Mm-hmm. And when the music started again, I saw her part again, sticking her leg out. I didn't even know what the exposure was. I just hit the button, and that was it. Just lucky. Mm-hmm. A lot of these shots are lucky. Mm-hmm. It would call lucky.
Jean, I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about the difference between. I mean, you used SLR. And of course, digital cameras are all over the place, iPhones, everything's a camera now. So what do you think would have been the difference if you would have had a digital camera instead of
a very interesting question, because there is a very famous photographer, John Stanmeyer, and he goes out into the field, the photographs, and he goes out because he's taking pictures
he's a National Geographic photographer. He's also a wartime photographer, and so he knows my mother.
So he said he used to use film, but he goes out now with a digital camera, because if he's shooting a scene, an army, and they're shooting everybody, he said, if I took my film, I would have to send it back and have it, developed and everything. He said, but. I have to take the pictures with a digital camera. And I said to him, if I had a digital camera, I would have been very happy, because with my film, when I took the photographs to put it into the newspaper for the jazz club, it would take 2 days. It would have to be developed and printed, and then they would have to put it into the newspaper. And so I said to John, I said, if I had a digital camera, I would have known right away. I wouldn't have had to shoot a whole roll. Mm-hmm. And that's why you see what we call
triptychs. What did he say?
Yeah. I just wanted to say the reason that you see triptychs is because they had to keep shooting all the time.
Oh, yeah.
So he said to me, if you had a digital camera and you had to look at the screen to see if you got that shot or not, you would have missed the next shot. And I probably would have missed that shot if I thought it was over and that was the end of it. So sometimes a digital camera does not serve your purpose. Mm-hmm. And so I'm still using film, by the way.
Jean, when you would go to a concert, how many rolls of film would you shoot?
Now, the intermission, maybe a whole roll of 36.
Okay.
I would just shoot, because I never knew whether. That's why you see a lot of my, like with Tito Puente over there, I would just keep shooting all the time. So when my book was being published, they came over and they were looking at some of my photographs. And I said, these were taken. He said, you know what? He said, we'll take all these pictures and put them into it. He says, it looks like it's a continuous movement. So the fact is that it came out to my advantage to keep shooting all the time, even though it was more expensive, which I was paying for, by the way. But so the digital camera wouldn't have been to my advantage at all. It would have been a disaster for me.
Yeah, I
wouldn't have gotten those shots. Yeah. I wouldn't have gotten that shot if I had a digital camera. After I would put my camera away. That was it. So I would take about 36, And of course, Marion McFarland, you all know about Marion McFarland and Milt Hinton. And I just want you to see, one of the difficult parts of taking, I'm sure photographers know this, taking a photograph with stage lighting, you have a black musician and a white musician. If I'm going to expose for the black musician, she's going to be completely gone, and vice versa. So what I had to do was to wait until the stage light came between the two of them. So some of the light, if you see the top of Milt Hinton's forehead, so some of the light was on him. I was able to get him in there, and then Marion McPartland. It was just lucky. And that's the idea of taking more than one shot, taking 36. The law of average is always on your side, you know? So Barry McPartland, of course, did the perfect kid. Barry McPartland, we're in Women in Jazz. So she just died just a little while ago. And I photographed Marion with the bassist Milt Hinton in 1995. Marion received a classic musical education in England. She played her weekly piano jazz, I'm sure that you all heard on NPR until just recently. She was on with, and so that was the difficulty of taking a photograph with stage lighting, with a black musician and a white musician.
You know what year that was taken, that one year?
I think you said 1995,
yeah.
He released his first album that year. He had never released an album under his own name.
Milt
Hinton. And he released his first album that year.
I didn't know that.
I saw him that year as well.
You gotta write another book.
He was playing everywhere. And it was just so neat to have a musician who's played on 1,001 albums.
Wow.
Or more.
Have
something under his own name.
Yeah.
Any questions, Jerry?
No, this is a perfect continuous shooting.
Yeah, this is where you...
And that's like a movie camera going. And so just shooting to... And the reason I was doing this because I wasn't sure that I was going to get a good shot, and the photo club, the jazz club, was going to be angry with me because they wouldn't have anything for their newsletter. So we have...
But you have four good shots here.
Yeah. Gene, did the jazz club ever suggest movie making of their performances?
There was a gentleman who was filming it. He got very ill and moved to South Carolina. I have been trying, and he's very, very ill, and I'm trying to find out who has that film. Mm-hmm. Nobody seems to. I have to go further to find out where it is. I think Dick Hyman knows where it is.
Yeah, he's going to check.
Yeah, because he. So that's a very interesting question because we have them all on film. Mm-hmm. Performing? That's a good question. You reminded me again because that's what we have to.
Yeah.
Wendy, that's your job.
You'd be in a good position to oversee the redoing of that film or the editing of that film and writing the commentary on the film. You were there for all of this. You'd be the perfect editor.
I was trying very hard. I wasn't very successful. Mm-hmm. Lolette Jenkins was born in 1928. She's still alive, and she's playing in Sarasota, Florida. She goes to the Senior Friendship Center. She goes all over playing with her, and she was always jumping up and down in her piano. And as a vocalist, and also sang, as a vocalist and pianist, she performed in the movie The Cotton Club.
Oh.
And Coming to America, as well on the Broadway, is called... She was on Broadway calling One Mo Time and Further Mo. You know that one? Yeah. Lynette is still really going strong, and she's performing for us in Sarasota, Florida. And now we have Carrie Smith, was born in 1925. She just died last year, 2012. She was in a nursing home Unfortunately, a lot of the, they ended up in nursing homes, and very, very sad, but she was a wonderful blues and jazz singer with roots in the gospel. And a lot of them came from the gospel. And her deep voice reminded me of her namesake. Remember Bessie Smith?
Yeah.
She almost like sounded like Bessie Smith. She sang with Cab Calloway and Benny Goodman and B.B. King. And she used to come and have all these bangles all over her head, and she was really a wonderful, wonderful singer. We missed her. Cleo Lane, she's still alive. She was born in 1927, so now she's 85. Her career started in the dance halls in England. She married saxophonist John Dankworth and came to the United States to perform and sing in many, many bands. A lot of times I don't go through all the bands that they played with because I'd be here forever. They all played with the big bands, and you know, Benny Goodman, Duke Ellington.
Was there a concert every week?
Every month.
Once a month.
Once a month. And the jazz festivals lasted 4 days.
And once a year.
Once a year. Yeah. Where are we now, Wendy?
I'll let people
read. Oh, keep on playing.
These musicians who played in so many big bands, when they had the reunion of the Tonight Show band, and the Johnny Carson and Dick Cavett, all of those TV show bands, there were so many different configurations over all those years. So this was about the core group who had played in at least one of those TV bands, and the Sarasota Jazz Festival brought all of these guys together for the first time in 25 years. Mm-hmm. Many of them hadn't played together and hadn't seen each other. So we just picked some of the people who performed in this reunion.
This starts with what, Clock Turner, right?
Yeah. Well, there's,
okay.
You'll see as we go along here. So first, go ahead.
The interesting thing, we have, well, you know, Jay Connor, and Bob Rosengarten with Bob Haggard. Now, Bob Haggard was the musical director for the Johnny Carson Show Band. Mm-hmm. And so these musicians, when they couldn't get a job, when Bebop came in and the Beatles came in, big band was over, they could not get jobs. So some of them went to the, like, they all went, some of them went to the West Coast, some stayed on the East Coast. They hadn't seen or played with each other for 35 years. Bob Rosengarten knew them all and kept in touch with them and brought them back. I was the only one that they allowed to take photographs. They were clowning around with each other. They hadn't seen each other for 35 years. Jack Hanna's saying, I don't want to hear from you anymore. And Bob Haggard and Bob Rosengarten, he's playing the bass, Big Noise from Winnetka, and he's playing on, with his drums, he's playing on the strings, and they used to clown around all the time. So that was so, that was so special. So here's Nookie Young and Sweet Tennyson, and here they are fooling around, clowning around with each other. And it's interesting, if you look at the first picture, you see Nookie Young looking at Harry Sweets. And now Harry Sweets is whispering into his ear. And so this was going on all afternoon, I mean all evening, and I was just delighted. I was just shooting and shooting and shooting. They were just clowning around with it. They were so happy to be with each other. And Claude Terry, of course, was born in 1920. He's 92 years old now, and he's very, very ill. And I spoke to him and gave him a happy birthday last year, but he was an incredible man. He was a world-class trumpeter and a composer. He also played the flugelhorn and a teacher, and he was a teacher, and his career, more than for 70 years, he played with all the jazz greats, too many to mention because I'd be here forever. Both Miles Davis and Quincy Jones credit him as an early influence. He has performed for 8 presidents and served as a jazz ambassador for the State Department. Mm. That's Clark Terry. And I call him every once in a while, but I'm very sad because he's very ill. And of course, we have Willie Belson, who was born in 1929. He's still alive. He's 22 years old.
No.
I mean, 88 years old. Okay. Talking too much. Louis Belson was 17 years old when he won a drum competition sponsored in Gene Krupa's band. He told the story about Louis Armstrong when someone asked Armstrong, "Do you play ahead of the beat or in the back of the beat?" And Louis said, and he responded, he says, "I just swing." And Belson was also just about swing. Bucky Pizzarelli, you all know Bucky Pizzarelli? Mm-hmm. He's still alive and going strong. 1926 when he was born. And he's best known as one of the only ones who plays a seven-string guitar. And his son John also plays a seven-string guitar. He traveled with Benny Goodman for many, many years. And he performed with the Boston Pops. He spent many years with the Tonight Show Band and performed at the White House. So a lot of these musicians played at the White House. They were invited to play at the White House. So that was Bucky. And Derek Smith was very famous with playing with Dick Hyman. They always played duets together. And he had this wonderful way of always lifting his shoulder up when he was playing. So when I was shooting all these photographs of him, I said, this is the one I'm going to choose because it's so part of what how he plays. And the emotions on his face is always very, very, and Dick Hyman used to just play, but he always had this expression on his face, so he plays also. Okay, so now we're off. Oh, one of my other favorites. They're all my favorites. 1922. Joe Wilder is still alive. He's 90 years old. Joe is considered one of the great trumpeters. He sometimes switches to his flugelhorn. As a classical music, see, a lot of these were classical musicians. They played as a classical musician in addition to jazz. He was a soloist with the ABC Symphony, New York Philharmonic, and in 2008, Joe was honored by the National Endowment for the Arts with the Jazz Master's Award. So he was...
Does he still play?
Yes, he did. He's still playing.
Gene, can I ask a question? Of course, we know that some jazz musicians die tragically young, but I'm wondering whether these musicians ever talked with you about any connection between their playing of music and their longevity. Mm-hmm.
They never mention that to me, and I don't mention my age either. That was never an issue, you know. As a matter of fact, when I was talking to them, I never even thought of their age when I was photographing them.
Somebody said to Dizzy Gillespie once, you know, so many, to your point, of your contemporaries have died young, given into drugs and alcohol. You know, how come that, you know, it hasn't happened to you? And he said, evidently you haven't met my wife.
That's good. That's great. Okay. Here we go. And so this is very, very important part of what Hal Davis, who started the jazz club, always wanted to have jazz continue because that was American's original art form. And the only way that he could continue jazz is to have the younger musicians mentoring with the older musicians. So we had Bucky, who we saw before, with his son John. We have Bill Tipton and Howard Alden, which I'll talk about, Clark Terry and Byron Stripling, and Bob Haggard and Ray Sargent. You know about all these.
All right, here we go.
Interrupt me in case you have something to say.
Yes.
Okay, here's Bucky and John. This was taken very early. John was about 22 years old, and Bucky was playing with him. He's always, when he came down with his son, he'd always say, "This is my kid." And now it's just the opposite. Now that John is up there playing on the radio, he's always saying, "This is my dad." So now he's introducing his dad. But they're both alive, and they're still playing together. And you can see on, I just happened to get this shot, how he was so happy about watching his father. And so this was part of the mentoring, of how these young people related to the olders and the olders related to the younger ones. And there is a very famous one. Here's Howard Alden. How old was Howard Alden? Milt was 84 years old, and Howard Alden was 36, so there was almost 50 years difference between the two of them. And I noticed how concentrated Howard was on, look at his face, and watching what Milt is doing. And look at Milton, with smiling, saying, as if to say, you know, you're doing great, kid. And there's something so special about how these musicians, legends, played with the young ones. And these guys are doing so fantastically well now. They're playing in big bands all over. And of course, there's my favorite again, Clark Terry and Byron Stripling. Now I'm going to quote Clark. He said, this is what he said to me, and I wrote it down. Teaching jazz allows me to play a part of making dreams come true for aspiring musicians. That was how he felt about working with younger musicians. He went on to say, and I quote again, a lot of people invented jazz. Kids have to learn who they were and how they did it. It didn't happen all at once. Miles Davis and Quincy Jones credit Clark as an early influence for them. So there was a very unbelievable historical picture. I mean, I just love the way he was looking at him. And there again, you see Bob Hadwick, you know Gray Sergeant? He's a very young, yeah, he's very, very young.
Young guy. Yeah.
And you can see the admiration. Just look at the expression on Gray's face and how he's watching everything that he's playing with the great Bob Haggard. Big Noise. They were playing Big Noise when Edgar. And Gray started to play when he was 10 years old. So what I was saying is so many of them started, either like Diana Krall was 6 years old when she started. So many of them were not only young, but they also started with, you know, they played classical music. Here we go. And there we are, that's what I was talking about. Kids are still carrying on. We had Diana Krall, you all know about Diana Krall. Okay. Yes, do I have Diana Krall? Kids are still carrying on.
And she's married to Elvis Costello, is that right?
Yep.
And Chris opened for in Keene.
Oh, here it is, I have it.
Yeah, that's
hey.
Right.
Okay, we have Diana Krall.
You did? When she...
Yeah, what's
yeah.
that?
A few years before that, she had opened for me on WRAMC radio
in
New York. It was unbelievable.
Oh,
overnight success.
Yeah.
You saw
wow.
this one.
So then
she was discovered, incidentally, playing by Clint Eastwood.
Oh, is that right?
He subsequently appeared in three of his movies.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Two of them in cameo appearances. But she had a gig. She wasn't trained as a singer or anything. She was supposed to be piano. But they expected women to sing also in certain situations. She was in Kuwait, I think. It was a Middle Eastern gig. She was playing a 6-star hotel.
Oh, yeah.
And Clint was on set on location. Just serendipity, yeah.
Wow.
Well,
next thing you knew, she was whisked off. And that's,
yeah.
Wow.
That's
so
the last time I saw us like this.
He didn't whisk you off?
So she was born in 1964, and here again, she started to play at the age of 4. She's from British Columbia, Canada. Her solo appearance at Carnegie Hall was a salute to Ella Fitzgerald in 1996, and that was the beginning of her career. She really did so well there. And there again, 20 years later, there's John Pizzarelli when he was playing with his father when he was 20. Now he's probably about 40 years old now, and so he was born in 1960, and he grew up listening to Nat King Cole, and his father, Bucky, was really his influence. And since then, he has struck out on his own, traveling throughout Europe and the United States. And he played for Frank Sinatra's 80th birthday.
Byron Stripling was born in 1961. In 1996, Byron went on to play with his masters, Snooky Young, Joe Wilder. You saw him in with a trumpet. He was the trumpetist, the vocalist, and he played Louis Armstrong in the Broadway musical Satchmo. And you see, he was holding the handkerchief like Louis Armstrong always had his handkerchief when he used to bring it up to me. So that he was taking off on Louis Armstrong. Well, we have now. Ken Kaposky is a fabulous, fabulous. He was born in 1959. He's only 53 years old. He comes to Sarasota, Florida, a great deal of place with Dick Hyman. And when you play with Dick Hyman, you have to know that he's pretty damn good. Mm. He is incredible. And he's a clarinetist, of course, and he also plays a Yamaha tenor sax. His first band was with Tommy Dorsey, and later with Benny Goodman. He is comfortable playing Dixieland and avant-garde jazz ensembles, so he can do anything. He plays a great deal in Sarasota, Florida, so I listen to him all the time. But he's playing with all the biggies. Played with John Lamb, which I'll talk about later, and he's ahead of my book. But he is fantastic. If he plays with the big guys, you know that he's pretty good. And then, of course, we have Arturo Sandoval, who was born in 1959. He's now playing in Miami, and he's 63 years old. He was born in the outskirts of Havana, and he was classically trained as a young man, and he became a protege of Dizzy Gillespie and was granted political assignment here in the United States in 1990. So. And he used to clown him. And there's another thing. I just kept shooting and shooting, and every time I shot, I got another everything that he was doing. It was just like in a movie. It's just moving like that. Yeah. And of course we have keeping Dick Van alive. Okay, Dick Hyman, a very 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 dear friend of mine. He did all the music for Woody Allen He wrote the foreword to my book. He's a good friend of mine. And he's a wonderful musician and pianist, and goes all over the world. So he's really very well noted for Woody Allen's movies that he made for them. Is there anything that you wanted to add, Dr. Connelly?
Well, did
he
do the last movie,
too?
The one that's...
The Blue Jasmine?
Blue Jasmine. Yeah, Blue Jasmine.
Because there's a lot of jazz.
Yeah, nice music.
Yeah.
He also did the movie that Cher was in.
Older movie?
Moonstruck?
Yes.
Moonstruck, oh, okay.
He got an Academy Award for Moonstruck. But he also does a lot of mentoring, and he was musical director for a lot of the Sarasota Jazz Club, bringing a lot of the young people and the legends together. Mm-hmm. And he's written a lot of books, and, you know.
Actually, he started with the jazz club in 1980, so he's been with the jazz club all these years. And I was very honored that he wrote the foreword to my book. Mm-hmm. Now, John Lamb is still alive, and he lives in St. Pete, right outside of Sarasota, Florida. And he plays with all the bands, and he's still going strong. He was born in 1933. And as a classically trained bassist, John has performed with the Boston Pops, New York, and Pittsburgh Symphonies. He played, of course, very famously with Duke Ellington. And he keeps telling us all stories about him and Duke Ellington. And he earned a Grammy Award for his recording, Far East Suit. And he's still playing in Sarasota, where he lives. And he is very, very wonderful going to all the... There are a lot of young jazz players. There's a group in Florida called the Jazz Juvenocracy. They're kids from high school, and I'm part of their group. I go there every Sunday to listen to them, and they just toured for the third year all the jazz festivals in Europe. They went to India, they went to North Sea, they went to all those festivals.
So John used to come to the, and sometimes when the base, one of the kids was in high school and he had to take an exam, he would fill in for him. So you know that he thought a great deal about these kids who were playing from jazz juvenocracy. These are high school kids.
You'd be taking photos of them. Because maybe in 20 years.
Of the jazz kids?
Yeah.
They had a professional photographer. Oh. So I didn't want to interfere with them. And he had a digital camera, so he took much better pictures than I could. And they wouldn't allow me to use flash.
All the old stuff.
So I think that's about.
Yeah.
I think so. I just wanted to. Thank you so much for listening. And for me, this book is really, I always say, is not about me. I can't believe that I was privileged to meet these musicians, know them personally, be friends with them. And I really, when I started, I really didn't know so much of their backgrounds until I started reading about them. I knew who they were, but I didn't know their backgrounds. And it just fascinated me. And it's just, forever, this is going to be the legends. And Smithsonian is interested in this because they have a big jazz department there. And they're looking for Bill Gottlieb.
Yes.
Did all of them from in the 1940s and 50s.
Sure.
And so Smithsonian bought all of his photographs. And one of the women that works for, who had worked for Smithsonian, said that eventually, not now, but these are, nobody has these photographs. I was the only one photographing them. So when they were yeah.
I was wondering if you were a jazz fan when you started taking the pictures.
That's very interesting. You know, as a young person, I used to listen to Benny Goodman a lot. And I used to jitterbug. And so that's, you know, and so that's why I love jazz. But when I started to get married and go to school and start teaching, I kind of lost the contact with music. Mm-hmm. And I was a Montessori school teacher, and I was teaching children who had learning disabilities. And so I really didn't know too much. I didn't follow anything that was going on for many, many years until I got down to Sarasota and met Hal Davis. And the reason we met is very interesting, that we moved to the same condominium in Sarasota, and we're both tennis, I'm a tennis player, and we're going, as soon as I moved down there, I went over to the tennis courts, and Hal Davis was sitting at the on the bench there, and he said, are you waiting for a game? I said, yeah. He said, so am I. He says, I'm Hal Davis, and I said, I'm Jean Germain, and we started to laugh because a mutual friend said, you should look each other up when you move down to the Cove. And the next thing he said to me is that, do you love jazz? And I said, yeah. But you know, I was kind of ingenuous about, I wasn't that much into jazz at that time because I was just retiring from teaching. So he said, I'm having some people over to my house and bring a jazz, everybody's gonna bring a record from the condominium that I lived in. And I looked through some of my records that my husband had, and I found the Benny Goodman record that, and when I turned it over, Hal Davis did the liner.
Oh.
And I said, and it was just, you know, this is like how things happen in your life. I never turned over the record to see who wrote the liner words. And it was Hal Davis. He said, how did you get this record? I said, my husband left it with me. So, you know, this whole thing just turned around. And then the next thing he says is, do you love jazz? He says, I said, okay, you know. He said, well, I'm starting a jazz club. And that's how it all started. And then he knew, as his father was, you know, a concert, he was had a jazz band in the 1930s. So all these legends came down. So that's how Hal knew them all. And so that's how he's in touch with all of them. So it was just a very lucky thing that we learned that I was going to play tennis that day and I didn't have a partner. And things happen serendipitously. Life is like that, you know? Things happen when you don't expect things to happen. The connections that you have
Until I got your book, Jean, I never associated Sarasota and jazz. I mean, why would one, a town, you know, somewhere in the middle of Florida? But does jazz now really infuse the life of Sarasota? Or would it be over if these concert series, you know, didn't happen anymore? What's the relationship between the town and the music?
After the last, Hal Davis was the president from 1980 to 1990.
Of the music center?
Of the jazz club.
The jazz club.
Yeah. And so he was the one who was putting on all the concerts. And he knew all these musicians. So
yeah.
He was there. So he was only there from 1980 to 1990. He died, and then Jerry Rucker took over and another 10 years, and he died. I mean, he became very ill. So what happened is that at that point, there was no one who really knew what to do, didn't have the background that Hal had or Jerry Rucker had.
Mm-hmm.
So some of these guys came along and nothing's happening. What they're getting some of the old timers who I hadn't even heard about, who are playing the bands, and who they were, I have no idea who they were. But they're trying to keep jazz alive.
Mm.
And so they're playing in nightclubs, they're playing at the theaters, they're playing, and every year we have a jazz festival. It's not the same. John Lamb came down with his group, but it's not the same.
Mm.
The legends are not there anymore. They're the ones who are just the leftovers.
Yeah.
I shouldn't say that. They're not leftover, but, you know, they're not the same. It's not the same as it was. It will never be the same. You know, so that's why I feel that the book is not about me. It's how I had the privilege and the honor to know them all.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, I'm not talking to you, Jerry.
That's okay.
I'm talking to you. I mean, you know,
I think that maybe if you were able to talk to some of these people now, if they hadn't passed on, they might say the same thing to you, that it was their privilege to know you. And look how you've continued on their legacy by these photographs.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. That wouldn't surprise me because they were very humble.
Yes.
The interesting thing is that Dick Hyman was the director for the 92nd Street Y, and he invited Milt Hinton, who was a famous photographer, to show his work there. It was 1998 or something like that. And so I was taking these photographs of Milt Hinton. So Dick says to me, I'm having Milt Hinton showing his work at the 92nd Street Y, and I want you to show your pictures with Milt Hinton. I said, I'm not showing my pictures with Milt Hinton. I said, I'm not in his league. He's a photographer. So Dick said, I want you to show your pictures. So it's in my book. It has a picture of me with Milt Hinton in the book. And when he showed Wendy, can you just put it up?
Jean, have you heard of the photographer Nate Singerman?
No, I don't think so.
Well, I hadn't either until this week in the Times. Matt Singerman. He was a photographer like you in 1950, lived in Ohio, and took a large number of photographs of the jazz greats in slide form and color. And this came to light in the Times just this week in an article by Stacy Baker in the Sixth Floor. And this archive is available at the Historic Films Archive in Greenport, New York.
Wendy?
But it's the same type of thing that you did, but he did it in the 50s, in the early 50s and 40s.
Wow.
Of Billie Holiday and all these jazz greats. And they were slides. So this fellow has purchased this this archive.
Yeah, well.
Nat Singerman, Singerman, and the slides are just incredible, and they're in color, which was unusual at the time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I think it was in the I just read it. Let's see, it was
in the magazine
September 4th today.
And who was the author of the story?
Stacy Baker. And it's a Baker. And it's a blog called The Sixth Floor, eavesdropping on the Times magazine.
Wow. And you know, Bill Gottlieb, Bill Gottlieb,
mm-hmm.
he photographed the Rolling Stones,
and you know his work. So he also was in that period of time, Bill Gottlieb. But so here's this picture of Milton Lee at the 92nd Street Y, and the pictures on the there's Milt Hinton, and the pictures. Because I'm not gender here, I don't look like that anymore. But anyway, so the pictures behind there are the two pictures that you see that yeah. here. And so after, so Dick Hyman said, "You got to show your pictures." I said, "I'm not." So we had a big fight about it. He says, so Milton says, "Gene, that's not a problem." So it went through, and I had my pictures up there. After the show was over, and that's what I'm telling you about these musicians. So humble, he's talking about me, and I'm no anybody. He says to me, I said to Milt, "I was so honored. I didn't even want to show with you. You're a famous photographer." And he says to me, "Gene," he says, "you are a good photographer too." That's what he said to me. I mean, so anyway, that's the story.
So you're gonna sign some books for yep. people who would like to purchase
sure.
them?
Sure, I would like to. Thank you, Jerry.
Well, thank you.
It was a very great privilege to be here.
Oh, it was a pleasure.